Hey guys, it's Ashley Nicole with Passion, Purpose, and Paychecks. Our next guest is very unique in that she turned her passion into her business. We have with us Keisha Howard of Blaze Breakers and Sugar Gamers. And as we see, you're already getting the game started. Keisha, how are you?
I'm well. I guess I should put this down.
Yeah,
thank you so much for having me here. This is awesome.
Yes, of course. Thank you for being our guest. So we actually just met recently, and I just found it so interesting that you are a gamer.
Yeah, I've been a gamer pretty much all my life. I have all brothers, so I started off always playing my older brother's games, so it's been a huge passion of mine for a while.
That's great. And I know you have two businesses, so I want to talk about each of them because
I think
they're both unique and different. Let's start with Blaze Breakers. When did you start Blaze Breakers and what is it?
Blaze Breakers is a digital branding agency. So basically, in March of 2016, I left my career after 14 years being in the real estate industry to go into marketing and branding full time. So one of the things that I love to do is get other people to articulate why they're doing what they do so it can be more authentic. I like the storytelling process in branding, and Sugar Gamers actually came first, and I met so many creative people that think differently that it allowed me to put together a really amazing team that can articulate a brand in a different way than you normally see. So it's exciting.
I love that. And I think we're going to talk about Sugar Gamers a little bit later because I think there's a really full discussion that we can have surrounding gaming and what you do specifically in that space. But in speaking about your branding business, who are some of your clients?
Oh, wow. I've had an artist who is selling street art, but he wants to teach his audience what investing in art means.
Mm.
I've had several musicians, a jazz musician, a hip hop artist, and a DJ. So a lot of entertainment people who really want to have something, some authentic message. And I kind of specialize in careers of people that are kind of a little bit more on the, I'm not gonna say boring side, but it's really hard to market yourself in the highly competitive field of for example, real estate or being a lawyer. And you can make being a lawyer glamorous, but it's hard, outside of, I make a lot of money and it's so many lawyers out there. How do you stand apart? How do you really make that pop? How do you really put that that message out there? So people who have more that work in finance and so on and so forth, we try to make give them a little bit more personality and pop with their message, with their web design, with their logos, all of that. So
that's phenomenal. And so in addition to the individuals that you've mentioned and the professionals, you've also, my producers tell me, worked with MTV, McDonald's. Tell me a little bit about how you developed those relationships.
Well, interestingly enough, it was because of my team. So again, going back to video games offers a world of different types of perspectives. It's not just entertainment, but the people who create them and play them just look at the world in a different way. So one of my team members is a musician, and she actually makes video game music. She's made music for video games, and in that we sort of collaborated on creating content for the McDonald's network.
Oh, wow.
So it was really cool.
That is really cool.
So she's made music for, I think, Xbox's Twister.
Okay.
So,
yeah.
We have another Sugar Gamer member who is actually on Just Dance, and she's dancing in Shanghai. So It's isn't that interesting? She's a dancer, but she works in the video game industry as well. So, all of us together collaborate and partner in different ways to be able to hit a lot of different industries and work with a lot of different companies. For example, I'm not super into sports, but my one of my most recent jobs was working with ESPN to give my perspective on competitive gaming or competitive esports.
That sounds really cool. So do you do that under Sugar Gamers or do you do that under your branding company?
Under Sugar Gamers, okay. I suppose, yeah. So, like, people know me from Sugar Gamers, which is how I ended up being able to have the branding company.
Oh, that's phenomenal. So, let's back up and go to Sugar Gamers.
Mm-hmm.
So, as I understand it, you started Sugar Gamers, and it's really a community of other people interested in gaming, or people that are already sufficiently in the gaming space. Is that right?
Well, it's more so an advocacy organization.
Okay.
What we want to do is advocate for underserved demographics in gaming technology and geek culture. Okay. Because you don't often see anybody that looks like us
in
a game at all.
So, yeah, that's true.
Which is a huge reason why a lot of women of color don't like necessarily find interest in it, because if we don't see ourselves represented, why would we want to do it? So, like, I am in that space we are in this space together to, you know, diversify it and to deconstruct it so people can see the different opportunities in it for themselves. So, you know, gaming, you know, it goes beyond just entertainment.
Yeah.
Like, when we think about it, we're just, like, thinking of some kid and they're not doing work and they're playing this game. But once you deconstruct the industry, that's just the last part.
Yeah.
Video games take music, it takes art,
yeah.
It takes more than coding and programming,
yeah.
That's important too, but it's just as robust and it has just as much variety as the team that needs to come together to create a game as, like, say, the movie industry or any other of the big industries that we respect. But we just don't know that because those aren't the conversations that we're having. So Sugar Gamers is out there to educate the audience on, like, what other aspects there are to game, like the intellectual merits.
Okay.
So, and we all come together. We're a diverse group of people to be able to speak about that. And it's been a super fulfilling experience. So
that makes sense. And you say that we all come together.
Mm-hmm.
I know that when you were younger, you played video games with your four brothers.
Mm-hmm.
How did you convert that passion into Sugar Gamers? How did the community of individuals start? Where did you find them?
Well, I mean, My brothers are, like, basically my best friends. And one of the reasons why I'm so close to them is because of that bonding experience that we had. And, you know, regardless of the challenges that we faced in our youth, we could always come together as siblings and sit on the couch and play games. And it was a very gratifying experience. And, you know, it felt like it definitely, in my opinion, strengthened our relationships. Mm-hmm. So, you know, as I got older, I realized that that's something that I could share with other people who aren't my siblings. And so even though gaming is known for, like, this online play, we make sure that we deliberately bring people out to meet each other and still have that sort of, bonding experience over a shared goal. Like, okay, we're gonna, you know, beat the race, we're gonna beat the game, we're gonna play together. And in person.
But did you find these individuals via Craigslist, or how did you find your community?
Oh yeah, interestingly enough, I did start with Craigslist.
Okay.
But it kind of sort of exploded at the time that I started Sugar Gamers through word of mouth. So like, women especially, Sugar Gamers started off as an all-female organization, but when I started it, women would bring in their friends.
Yeah.
Like, oh my God, my friend would love this, or my cousin would love this, and it just started to exponentially grow. And it was a super interesting experience because I didn't even realize I happened upon a good idea. It wasn't until, you know, I started to, like, see it visually that I was just like, whoa, all these people came out for this concept that I had. I didn't even think it would hit that heart, so to speak. So,
and so it started on Craigslist.
Mm-hmm.
You got great interest.
Mm-hmm.
And then it grew from word of mouth.
Yes.
And then you had in-person meetings where you all could come together and game.
Yes.
Now, I know that you're in the real estate industry, and I don't think people would traditionally think someone from the real estate industry would be a gamer and into geek culture. So how did you move out of the real estate industry into gaming full time? Talk about how the recession played a role in that.
All right. So, you know, as a kid, I was raised with my grandmother, and my grandmother, it was so important to her that I got a good job in an office with benefits.
Yeah.
So anything outside of that was just something that, you know, wasn't going to sustain me. And that was something that worried her. So, you know, get a good job, go to school, you know, do the steps. Yeah. So, you know, all my life, I'm hearing this story. So, of course, the harder I work, it's just going to be this upward trajectory. Yeah. And then eventually I'll be a millionaire.
Right.
You know, you just work at the job and then, ta-da, you get all these.
All of a sudden.
Yeah. And that is absolutely not how it works. And, it, you know, when the recession hit, that reality just came crashing down. Like, man, this, I put four or five years of my life into, like, making this work. And now everything that I worked for has disintegrated.
Yeah.
Because at the time, my clientele was luxury real estate buyers.
Okay.
So they're buying their condo downtown if they have their mansion on the, you know, in Winnetka or something.
Yeah.
Or they're buying their child a place while they're going to Northwestern or Loyola or something to that effect. So when the recession hit, people aren't buying,
right,
you know, second, you
or at
know.
Least they were downgrading in some sense.
Absolutely.
Yeah. So you were really in the luxury real estate space, which is really profitable and also really driven by money and people with money.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
And I definitely learned how to navigate that space, but I was never passionate about it. I never saw myself represented. When I remember, so the company I worked for and my employers were amazing was the Fordham Company, and they were the original developers of the Chicago Spire, and that was supposed to be the tallest building in North America. And just to see all the people that would get together to talk about financing it. How it was a very homogenous group of people.
Yeah, of course.
So, you know, it occurred to me that I might not ever get through that glass ceiling. Like,
but you had to have developed a certain lifestyle working in that job.
Actually, I did. Like, I drove a nice car, had a corner office, had my own private parking space, and I had access to luxury buildings.
It was
really great. So when this recession hit, I would talk to my employers. I'm like, how did you start? How did you get here?
Yeah.
And, you know, it was just process this journey of being confident enough to just go for it.
Yeah.
So it occurred to me, like, maybe I could do my own thing. And so then I just started exploring. And gaming has always been, like, this thread that has popped up throughout my life. So I was going to be on this show. And they loved me because they were trying to diversify their cast.
And which network was the show for?
Sci-fi.
Okay, cool.
So, and that they ended up rejecting me at the last minute because I wasn't that great of a gamer, which is a common misconception about me. People think that I'm just like this expert gamer and I'm really good, but I'm kind of terrible at games. I just love playing them.
Okay.
I have a lot of fun playing them. But anyways, so I was terrible, and they were just like, you can't be on the show. So I come back to Chicago, and I'm just like, you know what? I'm going to make my own, like, badass organization of women who game in Chicago. And that's kind of how that moment hit. That's kind of why I even put that ad in Craigslist, just to see.
Yeah.
It wasn't even like, oh, I'm going to be an entrepreneur and I'm going to make a lot of money at this. This was just like a moment where I was like kind of angry that, you know, the situation
the
played out.
Plan.
Right.
Yeah.
I'm just like, man, I tried to have this job. I went to school. I worked hard. That didn't work. I tried out for the show. They loved me. I did everything I was supposed to do. That didn't work. So, like, you know what? I'm going to just see what I can do on my own. And that was the first time I ever tried that.
Well, how large is your community of gamers now?
I mean, it's definitely well over 2,000 members.
Wow.
So they often like just sign up online or, you know, in Chicago, like we have various events. We create content. There's a lot that we do. So
do you have a newsletter to keep everyone engaged?
Or? Oh yeah, we have our website, and we have articles that come out, you know, pretty much every week. And again, our articles are about the perspectives of the different gamers that we have. So we just recently released an article about how, you know, gaming with somebody that might have depression can really help them. Another article that we had was about how horror games can teach compassion.
Huh.
And like these
interesting, really interesting topics. Things that I don't think you would think about gaming and its impact on depression and the positive influences that it can have. So obviously you have a lot of unique perspectives and a lot of knowledge in the space. How you measure profit differently now. Mm-hmm. After coming from a really luxury field, really, and doing very, very well in that, and seeing how corporations measure profit, how do you personally measure profit and success?
For me, like becoming an entrepreneur, I have to admit to myself that it's a little crazy.
Yeah.
I absolutely have more than enough experience to get hired for a six-figure plus job. Like, no doubts in my mind.
Yeah.
But the fact that I know that I'm doing something to help people, it really just makes me get up in the morning. Like, I've worked jobs and I'm just like, I don't want to do this. Like, and I'll get that paycheck. And the paycheck is great. But I don't, like, my when I wake up in the morning and I know that I have to spend the next eight to ten hours doing this job that I don't want to do, it kills me. Like, and I feel it. And it's like, I've never been so attached to the idea of being wealthy that I didn't take risk in other elements of my life. So, like, even though I have had fluctuations in the lifestyle I've been able to maintain, I can say that, especially in the last 2 years since I've started doing this full time, every day I wake up, it's like an adventure. Every day I wake up, I am so free to make whatever decision I want to make for my life. And that freedom and that power, it feels so powerful. It feels so good. It feels so, you know, like I feel like I'm living in my purpose.
Yeah.
And I can't pay for that.
Of course.
So
and that gives you a tangible benefit. So that really is payment in some ways.
It's absolutely payment. Yeah. And I've invested in people.
Yeah.
So people invest in me. So interestingly enough, you know, people are like, well, how much money do you make? I have not really missed out on experiencing the luxuries of life because the people that I help, the people that I invest in, want me to be in their life. They invest in me in turn. So even though I might not have had you know, a bunch of money to rent out a high-end facility, I can rent out a high-end facility to have my events.
Yeah.
Even though, you know, I can't pay for the things necessarily through like having so much work come in through the organization, but I'm always given the opportunities to experience those things from the perspective that I take as an entrepreneur, because people want me to diversify the space. People want me to talk about what I'm doing.
And I love something you said about investment. I think that that can't be overstated. The fact that, you know, my father always says, you reap what you sow.
Mm-hmm.
And there's times when you'll do stuff for free for people and you'll think, why am I doing this? But you do it anyways. And they may give something back to you, or someone else may just give something to you. And so you may not have the capital to do some things, but your investment in people always pays out. You always get a return on that.
And you know, a lot of people ask me, like, how do you cope with like the ups and downs? How do you cope with failure? And it's because like my support network is so solid. Yeah. Like for the first time, I feel like I'm not gonna fall because there's so many people that just, I know that they want Sugar Gamers and what I'm doing to succeed. And it's like, people be like, do you ever wanna quit? No, just like all the time. This is hard. It's undeniably hard. And I know like the entrepreneurial narrative is like, yeah, it was hard, but then one day I just made all the money and now right. I'm great. And you should do it too. Like, it's not like that at all.
Yeah, yeah.
It's very hard. And sometimes I just,
it's hard, yeah.
But, you know, so many people have just, like, they're just, you know, I'll get random text or random emails with all of these kind words, all of these words of support, and people that are compassionate about like how hard it actually is. And it keeps me going. It keeps me like, all right, I can do this another day. And then like, you know, 9 years later, I'm still doing it. And it's, you know, like, again, I've had the most amazing experiences. I've fought robots on TV. You know, like, I've just done the most insane, weird things I can't even begin to list.
And you've been helping people. I mean, one of the one great experiences you've had is you've done TED Talks.
Mm-hmm.
Tell me a little bit about how you were able to do that, because I know a lot of people, everyone knows, or most people have heard of TED,
mm-hmm.
and they've heard of TED Talks and TEDx Talks, but not many know how to actually get on this main stage or even a side stage. How have you been able to get into doing TEDx Talks?
Serendipity, I would say, but interestingly enough, I'm going to say this, the intangible approach and the tangible approach. The intangible approach was, like, I made myself available to it. I didn't get that opportunity until I quit my job, until I went into it and took that leap of faith. Then that's when people really wanted to talk to me and really wanted to work with me.
Yeah.
People really wanted to work with me when I was doing my business full time. And that was a hard decision to make. So as soon as I did that and I sort of knew that I had to make this work, mm-hmm. I think that I just started networking with more people. And I started being more open to responding to different things I saw online. I was just more open to speaking to people because I didn't have a paycheck coming in.
Right.
I had to, like, create opportunities.
Yeah.
And people thought that what I was doing was interesting enough to ask me to do a TEDx talk in Richmond, Virginia. So the tangible, like, that's intangible. It's like, well, you know, like, let's
how do I do that?
Right. Yeah. Like, how do I put my energies out into the world to allow things to happen? I'm sorry. Let me tell you about the tangible approach. Well, there are TED Talks that happen all around the nation, all around the world.
Yeah.
And basically, whenever they happen, number one, attend them, support them, because it's completely volunteer-based.
Hmm.
So the people who put them on, they're all volunteers. It's a lot of work. It's a lot of work.
Yeah.
So you can volunteer at these things. They if you go to any of them, if you want to go to something locally, usually the website has an indication of everybody participating. And you can reach out to them and ask, do you need help? Because it's volunteer-based. So a lot of people are thinking that people get paid for TED Talks or TEDx Talks. No. So, first of all, please don't think you're about to get paid. Like, if you going into a situation like that, stop. TED Talks is not for you. Secondly, you know, like, again, if you're trying to get into the circuit, you got to just be down to help and support the cause first and foremost. People, I think they forget that part. They see it, and then they just want to do it, but they don't do the in-between stuff. To, like, have people know who they are.
Yeah.
The second thing, tangibly, that one can do is make sure that their branding is on point. So I'm huge on branding. I'm huge on, you know, making sure that you put yourself out there. And I'm introverted. So, like, I, you know, talking to people isn't necessarily the easiest thing for me to do all the time. But it's something that I recognize is a must if I expect to get any exposure for what I do or any support for what I do. So your branding has to be on point, and you gotta put yourself out there to meet the people that are volunteering to put these big events on. So
if they want to do a TED Talk, and let's say they don't know someone, can they apply online, or will you personally ask to do the talk?
Yeah, typically you're invited to do a talk.
Okay.
So you have to know the people who are doing the talk.
Mm-hmm.
And
who are planning the TED Talks.
Right.
Okay. Okay.
So, and, you know, TED Talks are all about ideas worth sharing.
Yeah.
So a lot of people, I think, kind of go into it with the wrong approach of, like, oh, I did a TED Talk, now I'm going to be so relevant, I'm going to get all this exposure.
Mm-hmm.
Go into it wanting to help people. Like, go into it because you have an idea worth sharing.
Right.
So that doesn't mean that you have an idea that's going to make money. It's an idea that might change people's perspectives, might change people's lives, might inspire or motivate. So, like, what is, you know, like, have that first.
Yeah.
You know, so again, it's like kind of doing everything and then doing everything first, like, act like already have your TED Talk in your head, and then go for finding the people that can facilitate getting you there. But from my knowledge, I don't think you do have to be invited by the facilitators of the event. But you can there's actually,
but there's things you can do to help get that exposure.
Yes.
So to kind of recap that for folks, I just want to make sure I'm clear about this. You recommend making sure your branding's on point.
Mm-hmm.
People can volunteer, and those opportunities can even be local because they happen all over the nation.
Mm-hmm.
And importantly, go into it trying to help people and have an idea worth sharing.
Absolutely.
So that's all very, very helpful because a lot of people do see the platform and want to utilize it, which, I mean, who doesn't want a platform? And you're obviously an influencer in your space and an expert in your field. What advice would you give someone who has something that they love to do, they're really, really, really passionate about it, but they can't figure out how to make it their business? Do you recommend that they stay on their job for a certain amount of time and save up? Do you recommend they figure out how to make it profitable before launching the business? What would you say they should do?
It is definitely contingent on a person's personality type.
Yeah.
So, like, I am less risk adverse than most people that I've met.
Yeah.
So I am willing to just take a leap without a parachute. And that's not for everybody. It's just not. So I would not recommend my process to most people.
Yeah.
So for most people who want to make sure that they don't have to sacrifice so much. I mean, you're gonna, in my opinion, I think that anybody who is willing, you know, like trying to do what they love and trying to do what they're passionate about, they're going to have to, you know, make some lifestyle changes to make sure it happens. But be prepared and willing to make a sacrifice of some sort. Like, what are you willing to give to get, you know, what you want out of life? But yeah, I think everybody should really be, you know, in tune with themselves to know what kind of journey that they're ready to go on. Mm-hmm. Because, you know, I go to a lot of these entrepreneurial talks and, you know, everybody wants the money, and that's great. And I want money too. Everybody wants money. But, like, you know, that whole saying, if you do what you love, you never work a day in your life.
Yeah.
You know, making sure you stay authentic to yourself, because the idea of, you know, gaining monetary success, though very important, doesn't necessarily mean, like, that can really shift your authenticity.
And it can shift your values.
Yeah. And so it's like, what are you prepared to do? Because it's like, if you're going to, you know, keep your integrity, what does that mean? When I first started Sugar Gamers, a lot of investors were trying to completely change my business model. They'd be like, you know what Sugar Gamers would be good for? And I would be so willing to invest in it. And, like, you know, I see dollar signs in their eyes. They got the money to do it. You should make Sugar Gamers a dating site, because people want to date smart women and people want to date nerdy women. If I loved money and I wanted to compromise my integrity, I could be rich right now. I know I could, you know, like, or whatever defines wealth, you know, I know I could do it, but I'm just not, the thing that I'm doing is what I love to do.
So are you the sole investor in Sugar Gamers to keep it authentic?
Mm-hmm.
Mm.
So
your advice really is be authentic over everything.
For me,
for
each, everybody's journey is their own. And I think that there's not one way to do this.
Yeah,
like
there's
some people that's just like, do not quit your job until you have the money to, until you do not quit your, do not go forward with your business until you know it's monetarily sustainable. Do not do anything until everything is a sustainable, systematic process that you know is just going to work. Like, I did that already. I tried that with, you know, my entire 20s, and that didn't work. So
let me know this. How can our viewers connect with you? If they're gamers, they're interested in gaming, or they're one of those folks who needs help branding, how can they get in touch with you? Let them know.
All right. Well, if you need any help with branding or marketing or anything like that, I will be more than happy. Our team, it could be found at theblazebreakers.com. And if you're interested in gaming and the gaming organization and diversifying the space, then you would go to sugargamers.com. And if you're interested in just, you know, keeping it up with my adventures, and then I'm at gokeisha.com.
Amazing. Keisha Howard, thank you so much. Keisha Howard of Sugar Gamers and Blaze Breakers, all of her relevant links are below. Please connect with her, and you will not want to miss our next interview. So subscribe, follow us on Instagram at Passion Purpose and Paychecks. Go ahead over to our Facebook page, which is also at Passion Purpose and Paychecks. And as always, our website, passionpurposeandpaychecks.com. Check out our latest blog. Talk to you all soon, and do not forget to subscribe. Thanks for joining us.